Hello gamers, welcome again to Xcoder Videos, and also welcome to the Microhard Session 9, where we will be looking at the MUX4B task and completing that in the Microhard program. This video, we're going to be using the digital program again, like we did in the last. But I've done a little bit of the work up front so that to save a little bit of time in the video. But first, let's take a look at the specification for the MUX4B. The MUX4B element is a bus version of the MUX gate, the one that we created earlier. And it transfers the whole data of one of the input buses to the output bus, but otherwise behaves identically. It has three inputs, a 4-bit in one bus, a 4-bit in two bus, and a 1-bit select bus. And then it has four outputs, one output, which is a 4-bit out bus. And this is what the looks like in the graphical representation. Now, interestingly, in effect, this component is nothing more than four single-bit MUX gates tied together, where the select input goes to each one of the gates, and the four bits of the in bus and in two bus go to the in pin of the of each MUX gate, and the same thing for the out buses, or the out pins go to each pin of the out bus. There are two select cases, and there are actually, this just shows two examples in the truth table, but there are two select cases and eight bits here of data can represent, four bits represent 16, 8 bits can represent 256 inputs. So there are actually 512 entries in the truth table for this component. Unlike the demultiplexer that we did last in the last video, the 4-bit or the MUX4B multiplexer can use the single-bit multiplexer that we used before, and that's how we're going to design this component. So let me bring over digital, and I've done a little bit of work in advance, and I've learned a little bit more about digital that may be of interest to you. I found out how to make a bus version of the inputs and the output components. In the input component, all you need to do is add the input component like so, and bring it in and attach it to the workspace, right click on it, and then tell it how many bits you want that input to contain. In this case, we'll use 4 bits, and then you can give it a label if you want to, and then click OK. And that makes that into a 4-bit bus, 4-bit bus input. And I've already done that with these two inputs up here, so we can just delete that. This little component, actually it's not a component, it's found under the wires section, which means that there's not any active components in here. It's just the way the wires are set up. But what this does is it will split incoming bus to an outgoing bus, and it can also take, well, for example, in this case, we have four bits coming into it, and going out of it, we have four individual bits, not going to a bus, but to wires. And so that brings the wires out of the bus so that we can direct them to the proper location. And the same thing over here, we've got, let me just go ahead and take a look at this, show you how this is set up. The input splitting, you tell us how many, in this case, how many bits in the bus for the input do you have? And we've got four. And how do you want the output split? And we want one pin for each of the four bits in the input bus. And that gives us a component that looks like this, with four bits coming in on the bus and then each pin going out with a single input. If we go over here and look at this one, it's a little bit different. In this case, we've got four bits coming in as individual wires. So we have 1, 1, 1, 1. And the output is going to be a four-bit bus going into the output port there. So that's how that is created. And that's pretty neat that it does that. Now we can work with buses in a similar way that we have buses in Microhard. So the wiring for this is pretty simple. The select input has to go to each one of the muxes, and there's not any kind of controls or anything. You don't have to put any controls in here, because it's just a simple matter of sending it each one of the muxes a 1 or 0, and so we just tie it up like that. And then each mux has two inputs. This would be the input for 1, and this is the input for 2. And we start with mux 1 needs to get the first bit out of N1. Mux 2 gets the second bit out of N1. Mux 3 gets the third bit out of N1, and so on. And then the same thing for N2. Mux 1 gets the first bit out of N2. Mux 2 gets the second bit out of N2, and so on. So let's wire that up. We'll do the N1s first. And this one goes to the second bit. Third bit. And then the fourth bit. And then we do something similar for N2. And that is all the inputs that we want. And now the output is very simple. We just simply tie in the out from MUX 1 to this component here. The out from MUX 2 to that component. MUX 3 goes here. And finally, MUX 4 goes here. And if we've done everything right there, that should give us the complete component that we want for the MUX 4B. Let's take a look at the analysis here and go to analysis. There And we've got an error here. There are 1 bits needed, but 4 bits found affected multiplexer signal out. Okay. We failed. Well, it says signal out is 4 bits. It's saying it's only got 1 bit there, so I'm not sure why. But that's a problem with the with this program. It's not a problem with our logic. Delete that and then tie. It doesn't look like they were connected properly. I don't know. Let's see. Should be, the output is 4 bits. Let's try that, maybe. No. 1 bit needed, 4 bits found, affected. Multiplexer, signal out. Well, maybe I haven't figured these this wiring business out yet. I'll have to do some research on that to figure out how that works. But I believe we've got I wonder why that is red. That may be the error right there. Component would choose the value of the select pin to decide which input value set to the output exportable. Okay. Input bit. Out the value of the selected input. In 0. In 1. Well, I'll have to look at that to figure it out later. But let's go back into Microhard, and we'll tab over or press enter to go over to the workspace, and then tab over to design. And we have our inputs and outputs already added to the design. All we need to do specify the four components that we're going to use in this design and wire it up. So we want MUX 1 is going to be a MUX, and we've got four of those to create. One, two, three, four. And that completes our parts specification. And now the wires. The wires are going to, we'll do the in to the muxes and then the outs from the muxes. So in N1, comma, 1 is going to MUX 1 dot N 1 and N 2 dot 1 is going to MUX 1 dot N 2, and we want that 4 times, and this is going to be a 2, 3, 4. MUX 2, 3, 4. Two, three, four. And 2, 3, and 4. And now we have the outputs to define. MUX 1 dot out is going to out 1, and we need that 4 times. And I believe that is the complete specification. If we hit Control Enter and everything is fine, then we're done. Let's take a look. Control Enter. Failed. Wire MUX1 out to out1 is declared multiple times. So I see what we've done here. We forgot to change these values. Getting a little ahead of myself. 2, 3, and 4. Now that should do it. Let's go Control Enter. And it still failed. Okay, what has happened in here? Doesn't look good. So we've got this one has N2 was selected, but we didn't get the N2 out. So let's see why that happened. All right. Select. Oh, we never did wire the select up, did we? That's a problem. That is the problem. Okay. Don't forget wires. That hurts. Okay, so cell 2, MUX 1, cell. And we need that 4 times. Sorry about that. That was entirely my fault. Just not paying attention to what I was doing. And let's see if that doesn't pass. All right. That time everything worked exactly the way it was supposed to. We've got cases in the... Oh, no, wait a minute. We've got more than 27. What did I say that we would have? We should have 512 cases. And every one of them is passing. Sometimes I forget that these tables will scroll. And I think we're only seeing part of the table. And the whole table actually is given. So that's 512 test cases, and each one of them passed. We can go on now. Let's see what they're going to give us this time. All right, we've got a new briefing unlocked. You unlocked a new briefing, ALU. Okay, and we've got a register that is unlocked and an arithmetic logical unit 4B, and so we've got two new tasks before us, and we have a new briefing. Let's take a look at the briefing, and then we'll complete this video. Okay. Oh, there's also a briefing on sweet DFFs. Not sure what that is, but we'll see. Ted finished a design for us, MUX4W16B. Thank you, Ted. Ted finished another design, the MUX16B, and we've unlocked the register. Ted finished a design, the DFF. I wonder what he created the DFF for, because I don't think I ever created any DFFs, but we'll have to see that. And let's take a look at these briefings. Great stuff. We're getting closer to blowing up the CPU marketplace, step by step, design by design. As you might know, the actual computations a computer performs are done by its arithmetic logical unit, ALU. And the exciting thing is we basically got everything together and we need to build our own ALU. You just need to wire it up. At the risk of repeating myself, make sure you draw out your design on paper first. Okay, Will, thank you. Let's look at the sweet DFFs. The best CPU in the world isn't worth a whole lot if you can't save the program that drives it or the results it produces. Something that all the hardware elements you designed so far have in common is the absence of memory. We need to change this. That's why I got a business associate to source some sweet D flip-flops. When designing sequential elements, make sure you consider the timing aspect. We haven't done any sequential elements yet in Microhard, but it looks like that is coming up pretty quick. Check out the chapter on sequential logic in the manual and have a look at the spec sheet for the D flip-flop under the completed folder. Will, why don't we go ahead and, well, yeah, let's go ahead and take a look real quick at that. And no, I don't want to leave. I just want to go down here to the completed folder and see the D flip-flop. The DFF element saves the value it receives on its input and outputs that value one clock cycle later. Its behavior can be described as out T equals in T minus 1. And the property to maintain a state across a clock cycle makes the DF element the base of all memory elements. Check out the manual chapter about sequential logic. We will do that in our next video. The interface specifications are, it has one input, single bit, and has one output, a single bit. So the graphical representation of the D flip-flop is what we see here. The first time DFF comes up, its output is going to be a zero. That is the default value. And the N will be N could be zero. And then the next one, the N would be, the output would be one, one, and then N, one. We're looking at this in sequential order. N, one, and zero, it's still one. And so you can see it kind of follows the input, but one clock cycle later. And that's what the D flip-flop is for, the D flip-flop. And that's going to be important for us, I suppose, in future tasks. Well, I appreciate your watching our video today. If you've enjoyed this, please consider giving us a thumbs up. That helps the these videos to move up a little bit and be more likely to be presented to individuals who are looking for similar type of information. So it really helps out when users do that. Again, thanks. We'll see you in the next video.